Okay, so for our second class, we will actually discuss about software development cycle and software engineering in general, and then we'll get into web programming for this semester. So the topic of today's class, let me present, is software development life cycle. So again, this is the first actual lecture for CSE 316, Fundamentals of Software Development. And the topics of this class will be an overview of software development lifecycle, the stages, the standard stages in a software development lifecycle, and then process models. It's basically a crash course on software engineering. And one of the textbooks that I listed last time in the course syllabus was this textbook on by Somerville on software engineering. This is kind of like a summary of the whole idea without going into details into any one of the different topics, requirements, and collection or evaluation or design and so on. So what is a software development lifecycle? It's a structured set of activities required to develop a software system, a relatively large software system. But most of the software systems today are relatively large. So basically, all of them are going through a similar software development lifecycle. And there are many different software processes that are employed in industry, but all involve the following steps. Specification, which basically it's a formal document that defines what the systems do, is also called requirements or requirement analysis in software engineering. Then design phase, which is basically a step in which one develops the architecture of the system, basically the higher level design of the system, what are the components, if it's a large system needs multiple components, and what is the integration between those components. Then a more detailed design for large software projects, you have a higher level detail design, and then a detailed design where you have the design of the component modules or packages, the data structures used, the algorithms. Then you have the step of implementation and coding and testing of the system. Validation, which usually is done by a special team of testers, checking if the code works and what does it if it does what the customer wants. So usually for a large system, there are thousands of requirements, all individually defined, and validation tests are developed for every one of those requirements. And usually this is done in a black box testing. Basically means that the tests are developed independent of the system whatsoever. They are based on the original specification. Therefore, basically the test have to pass because it's basically a test for the original specification or the original requirement. So it checks whether the program actually works and does what the customer wants. Then there is a step of deployment, putting the system in production on the customer's, now it's all in the cloud, but before it was on the customer's system. And of course, any system needs updates. So evolution is really the phase which basically changes in all possible parts. Sometimes changes in the requirements require actually re-implementation of redesign, re-implementation of those features, validation testing, and so on. And basically, evolution is all about changing the system in response to changing the customer needs. So there are, as I said here, many different software processes, but one that is the standard one in industry, it was basically developed 30, 40 years ago, it's called the waterfall model. And really the reason why it's called the waterfall model is that you basically have a waterfall of steps, and only when you finish all of these steps, you can basically go back and change the entire system. But basically, the specification and then the development, the design, the development, the testing is all done in distinct phases that follow one after another. Okay, and this is a classic waterfall model. Now, there are, of course, more newer, modern models, which are the incremental development, maybe plan-driven, like the waterfall model, or agile, which basically there was an agile manifesto that was advocating for adaptive planning and evolutionary development, early delivery to the even of incomplete specifications to the customer, continual improvement, and encourages flexible responses to change. And this basically agile manifesto had a lot of basically rules and ideas of how can an application be developed incrementally in an agile way. And it has all kinds of requirements, like every day, at the beginning of the day, the development group meets for 15 minutes. Everybody has to stand up, and because then they don't have this basically feeling that I'm going to sit down for a long meeting instead of actually implementing the deliverables for that day. And really, the idea of the entire incremental development is that specification, development, and validation are interleaved. And therefore, specification doesn't have to be complete before you actually can do coding and development. So it can be that you have a few requirements, you develop them, you validate them, then the customer gives another few requirements, and so on. Then another software process model is integration and configuration, also can be plan-driven or agile. And really the idea here is that, and usually is used in financial systems, that the system is assembled from existing configurable components. So basically the job of the software engineer is to find the corresponding components that can be used in developing the larger system. In practice, most large systems use elements from all of these different models, waterfall model, or incremental, or integration and configuration. Most standard and every single software engineering textbook covers is waterfall model. It basically it addresses each one of the phases separately, and really the good advantage is that it can separate these phases, and one can actually address each one in a standard way. So requirement analysis is the first phase, and actually it requires writing of a document, a standard document that specifies what are the requirements, what is basically in the case of a graphical user interface, you would basically have every single screen mock-up, and then what are the interactions with this screen. Those are basically user interactions with the screen, and what would be the next, the effect, both on the database, on the model, and on the next step, basically what's the next screen that will be shown. After requirement analysis is completed, the design phase starts, and usually again, there are standard ways to write the design document using UML class diagrams and sequence diagrams. And basically it has two phases, the static design, which is usually package diagrams or module diagrams and class diagrams. And then it has the sequence diagrams, which define what are the interactions between the different methods or the different classes or objects between basically during for every one of the use cases that was defined in the requirements. Then after a design is complete, again, the waterfall model requires that all of these phases complete before you go to the next one. So after a design document is produced for the entire system and is complete and correct, then the implementation phase starts and is also sometimes done in parallel with unit testing. Every feature is implemented and tested, and then is followed up by integration testing and system testing, and finally operation and maintenance. So basically the waterfall model dictates that every one of these steps has to be completed before the next one is implemented. and basically develop. The drawback, of course, is that it's very difficult to accommodate change, and no project is complete when you actually design it at requirement analysis. So the main drawback of waterfall model is that every phase has to complete before moving to the next phase. So this is the inflexible, especially for business systems where requirements change frequently. And if you think about large systems that take years to develop, like even games, computer games, standard computer games take between 3 and 10 years to be developed. So by the time that one finishes one phase, it would basically be too late to change anything in the requirement specification. So it's really good for large systems developed over multiple sites because it can distribute the work throughout multiple teams, but it has this disadvantage that you can't change it easily. And it requires a lot of design to actually implement a correct system, a correct and complete system. So more modern systems, especially those developed in companies that develop a single product that evolves over time, like Google Gmail or Facebook social media, are using incremental development. So you have an outline description of the entire system, and then there are concurrent activities of specification, development, validation. Then you basically return to specification, development, validation. And in each one of these phases, you can basically loop back and forward as you implement the different phases. The result of incremental development is that you have at any moment a version, an initial version that is incomplete, of course, but it can be shown to the customer. There are many intermediate versions which may complete what the customer developed as requirements up to now, but they are not complete with respect to the entire system. And the final system maybe is never achieved because basically the customer always asks for updates. Especially in many of these cases, there are no final systems. Right? Basically, the development company becomes, or the customer becomes a subscriber to the actual software engineering firm to have updates done at any moment. The benefits of incremental development are that the cost of accommodating changes is reduced, less specification needed at the beginning. You can modify the design at any moment, both the requirements and the design. You have to rework the analysis documentation, but it's still minimized. You have updates, incremental updates. It's easier to get customer feedback because the customer is basically in the loop. He has to validate every feature and specify the next feature in the specification, basically the specification, which is done through customer interviews, is part of the entire concurrent activity of development. So it's easier again to get the customer feedback. The customers can comment on demonstrations of the software all the time. They can actually test the software, the current version of the software, can see how much is implemented at any moment. It's very rapid delivery of incomplete project, but still useful software to the customer. And the customers are able to use and gain value from the software quicker and make changes. Of course, there are drawbacks, and the main drawback is basically the fact that the process is not visible. There was no initial requirement specification document that basically the developer implements, and that's it, basically. The managers need regular deliverables to measure progress, and they have to define measures, which are not actually the completion of the project, but actually number of tasks that are implemented or number of change tasks that need to be implemented. Still allows for rapid development, but it makes it non-cost effective because now the development company basically works with the customer to update all the time the software. And if a cost was agreed on at the beginning, that may not be the case after 1 year or 2 years, when maybe now basically the project is running over cost. And there, that's the reason why in this kind of incremental development, a subscription model is actually in most cases required. Also, the system structure degrades with new increments. Usually, like when you have a waterfall model, you can actually dictate the constraints on the architecture in the requirement analysis phase, because in that specification phase, you know how many clients will be basically helped and what's the entire set of requirements, while in the case of incremental development, you may have large changes in requirements. So you need to update the entire system in many cases. Sometimes you need to update the entire implementation whatsoever. You choose a different stack, a different full stack development. So it may require extra time and money needed to refactor the entire code. And the alternative to that is to have regular change that basically can corrupt structure, and full future changes may become increasingly difficult and costly. So it's really good from the point of view that is agile and it can update the customer with versions rapidly, but it may actually cost more than a waterfall model if you don't have a correct, basically, framework that can be extended easily. Another type of, as I said, another software process used in financial industry usually is integration and configuration process modeling. It's based on software reuse. Basically, large systems are integrated from existing components or application systems. And these components are sometimes called commercial off-the-shelf or COTS systems. They basically, the development company took various subcomponents and integrated them into one single, basically, system. And you can take as an example Drupal. It's basically one system developed for basically large collaborative document development, like wikis, and you basically you use it off the shelf, and you develop it. You basically can configure it for your specific company. Maybe you can enhance it with text search, but in most cases you use it as is, but internally for search within the documents of your company, or for the development of your documentation. So thus, these components may be configured to adapt the behavior and functionality to the user requirement, and reuse is the key word and the standard approach for building many types of business systems. As I said, in financial companies, this is usually what is used. Companies like IBM and Microsoft are developing off-the-shelf systems like accounting systems, and they basically make them available in a bank. But the bank may require small changes to adapt to their own basically database. But these are still a configuration integration model overall. So let's start over the standard basically steps in software engineering. And the first one is requirement engineering. Basically, in this requirement engineering, the company has to establish what are the services that the customer requires from the system, what are the constraints under which it operates and is developed, and these constraints can be time constraints, how fast the system should respond back, or memory constraints, how much memory will be needed by the system. And this it requires a precise definition of the behavior of the system that should exhibit. And the system requirements are precise descriptions of the system services and constraints generated during the requirement engineering process. So it's basically a collection of the requirements for that system. And the requirements have to be very simple and precise. And usually a large system has thousands of such requirements. And of course, for each one of the requirements, one can develop tests or establish tests so the system is finally validated at the end. So the types of requirements are of two kinds, user requirements and system requirements. And the user requirements are basically statements in natural language, sometimes controlled natural language with simplified grammar and vocabulary, plus diagrams of services that the system provides and its operational constraints. So basically, if you develop a graphical user interface with one screen that has a button, okay, user requirement may be what happens when you click okay, that the username is saved, that the password is sent to an authentication service, and the next page can be one of the two, authentication failed or authentication succeeded, and you are taken to the home page of the application. It's written primarily for customers. The customer has to basically be interviewed, and a document is produced with what are the requirements step by step of the system, what the screenshots in the case of which basically it's a mock-up screen in the case of graphical user interfaces, and what are the interactions with the user. And then there is the second type of requirements, system requirements. It's a structured document setting out detailed description of the system functions, services, and operational constraints. And it defines what should be the implemented, so maybe part of a contract between the client and the contractor, and is written primarily for engineers that know exactly precise requirements for the system, and they can actually value the implementation of every one of those requirements. And the steps for developing the requirements are that first there is this requirement elicitation, basically an interview or a research and discovery of requirements of a system from users, from the customers, and other stakeholders. The stakeholders are the various agents that are basically involved in a system, in the development of a system. The requirement specification is the writing of the formal requirement specification document. And there are standard formats like the IEEE requirement specification template. Then there is the requirement validation for large projects, where the requirements documents is checked for consistency, completeness, and correctness. Basically, every input has to be accounted for, every output has to be accounted for. If there is a state change in the system, all the states have to be well defined. What are the possible properties of that state? Basically, fields that need to be filled. And basically, what is the, if every single state is reaching the system and you can get from the initial state to the final state, it's really like an automata in automata theory, in a state machine. Now, the truth is that requirements change, and they may change actually during the requirement analysis phase, or they may change after the whole project is implemented. And this is inevitable. You basically will have changes of the specification document due to the changes in the user requirement, increased understanding of the stakeholders' needs, customers, users, clients of those customers, customer reorganization restructure, and availability of new technologies. So sometimes really the problem that you're trying to develop maybe is already implemented in some partial way in a system, so you can actually use integration of that specific part. So in order to write that requirement specification document, there are guidelines for writing these requirements. And the first guideline is choose a standard format and use it for all requirements. And there are standard formats developed by companies, and also those that are basically made available by standardization non-profit organizations in most cases, like the IEEE standard documents. And In all of these documents, they have a precise definition of what is the language that you need to use, and it has to be used in a consistent way. Use shell for mandatory requirements, like the system shall implement user credentials validation. Use should for desirable behaviors, and all of these have to be highlighting to identify the key parts of the requirement. So basically use a different font or a different underline the shell, so you know what are the required parts and what are the ones that are desirable, and maybe they are associated a flexible price. If they are implemented, then you get the salary. If they are not, you don't get that part of the salary. Avoid using computer jargon. Really, these documents are developed for the customer, and the customer doesn't know what MERN stack is or anything like that. They are doctors in the hospital, for instance, and they know what they want, but they don't understand what we call a standard jargon in computer science. Include an explanation, rationale of why a requirement is necessary, if that is not evident, basically, for the customer. The customer may not know, again, specific things that are required for a web project, but they have to be educated. So, again, there are two types of requirements, user requirements, and I have here a slide that is duplicated, but I already talked about it. Sorry about that. There are functional and non-functional requirements. And the functional requirements are statements of service that the system should provide, how the system should react to a particular input or event, how the system should behave in particular situations, and states what the system should do. Many states, it may state what the system should do. And there are the non-functional requirements, which are nothing to do with the interaction with the user. They are constraints. And these constraints, as I said earlier, they can be constraints on the services and functions offered by the system, like the timing constraints, how fast the system should react for an input, constraints on the development process, like the memory constraint, how much memory should be used by the system. In the end, that's actually a cost that the customer will pay, maybe not to us, but to a cloud provider, and the use of standards. Often applied to the system as a whole rather than individual, basically, features or services. So basically, you have the functional requirements, which are interaction with the user, and the non-functional requirements, which are constraints on basically how much memory, time, and what standards should be used. And there are the domain requirements, which are constraints on the system for the domain of operation. So sometimes, if you develop, for instance, an application for the Stony Brook Hospital, you have to follow the rules of the law, HIPAA regulations, for instance, with the Health Information Privacy Act, that what kind of data you can store, what kind of data you can make public or you can use for research, as opposed to what kind of data is completely private and cannot be stored, cannot be made available for research. Similarly, in education, there are regulations like the Federal Education Privacy Act, which dictates what kind of information can be shared with different stakeholders. So functional requirements describe the functionality of the system. Depends on the type of software. Expect the users and the type of the system that the software is used on. Functional user requires maybe a high-level statements, what the system should do, authentication. It doesn't have to go down into collection of the password, encryption, and things like that. It has to be a higher level that the customer understands and appreciates. And functional system requirements should describe the system services in detail, one by one. And as I said, there are thousands usually for a system. Then there is system requirements, and everything has to be complete and consistent. In principle, the requirements documents should be complete and consistent. Complete means that they should include all the facilities required and all of the requirements, functional requirements. And consistent, should that there should be no conflicts or contradictions in the description of the system facility. So for instance, consistency is also check that you don't have states of the system that are defined in the requirements document, but they are never reachable in any possible way. So it's really, consistency means many different things. There are no cycles, there are no states in which you have contradicting information. So it's a consistent requirement. And of course, such consistency and completeness cannot be achieved in general, in practice, because it's impossible to produce a complete and consistent requirements document. But we try our best. Basically, that's what is software design and requirement analysis. There are good writing requirements, requirement analysis, and basically requirements should be unambiguous. They should state one responsibility each. There shouldn't be a rule that if something, then something. No, it should be what is the property that has to hold in this state, nothing else. Be testable, verifiable. So in we have to develop the requirements in such a way that we can individually test every requirement. Be positively stated. You should indicate what the system should do rather than what it shouldn't do. And really, some software engineering textbooks tell you that you should also tell what the system shouldn't do in every single state. But that's not quite correct, because the set of things that the system shouldn't do is infinite. It's basically open world. The system shouldn't do anything that is possible in the world. So basically, in most cases, you have to state only what is required and nothing else. If something is not required, it's understood through failure of not being required that that doesn't need to be implemented. It's negation as failure. If it's not true, then it's false, definitely. Now, as I said, large systems have thousands of requirements, because these are very simple requirements, step by step. Even the type of projects that we do in this class have dozens to hundreds of requirements, simple, short requirements. So that's why a real system has thousands. Okay. So once the phase of requirement analysis is finished, the next phase is really design. And it has two parts, system architecture and detailed design. System architecture is actually the overall high level view of the system. It defines the context, the modes of use of the system architecture with the subsystems and interfaces, and then a detailed design of each one of the principal objects. So we have to identify the principal system objects, develop the design model, specify the object interfaces. And they have to be thin interfaces. Every object should have only the required set of functions and nothing else, and a small set of functions that are not composed of other functions. So the context, the system context interaction view, is that we have to understand the relationships between the software being designed and the external environment. And it helps us decide how to provide the required system functionality. It also helps to decide how to structure the system to communicate with its environment. Basically, in essence, we have to understand the context that helps establishing the boundaries of this system, and what interactions this system has with other systems. Basically, we implement the systems of this, of the features of this system or the requirements of this system, and maybe some features, some requirements are actually implemented in other associated systems, and we have to define the interface with those associated systems. The context and interaction models is basically the model, the process model that actually defines this context and the interaction with other systems. So the system context model is a structural model demonstrating other subsystems in the environment of the system being developed. It focuses on the look of the entire system and other systems around it and how it interacts with those other systems. And it usually is illustrated by UML class diagrams or module diagrams, and is a static view of the system. The interaction model is the dynamic view of how this system interacts with its environment and other systems, and is illustrated by UML sequence diagrams. Now, in CSE 114, you actually learned class diagrams, and this module diagrams are really just an extension of class diagrams, but which are basically interactions between modules and relationships between modules. In this class, later this semester, after we learned actually the programming part, we'll learn sequence diagrams. Sequence diagrams are basically how each object interacts with other objects through the call of methods and returns. So in this class, we'll actually learn three types of UML diagrams. Class diagrams, which is the ones that you learn from CSE 114 and probably also in data structures, CSE 214. We will learn use case diagrams, which is used in requirement analysis. We talked about that previously, but there are a standard way to represent in UML a use case where you have the agent and what is at the conditions, preconditions, and effects of every interaction. And then we'll talk about UML sequence diagrams. And sequence diagrams are basically this. You will see they're basically every object will be a vertical line, and you have to declare in time, and the vertical axis is basically time, from time zero to future time. And you have, if a method is called, what other methods are called from other objects, and what do they return, when do they return. Now, architectural design, so once the whole interaction between the system and the environment is understood, this information has to be used in designing the system architecture. And the system architecture, in the system design or architectural design, the idea is that the system will be composed of subsystems, and you have to identify these major components that make the system and their interactions, and then organize these components using an architectural pattern like layered or client server model. Basically, you have to decide what is the client, what is the server, what are the interactions, who calls whom, and what is returned or what is called further, and so on. So it's really kind of like a sequence diagram, but it has the same two parts. It has a static, which is about what are the different parts of the system and how do they interact. And then it has a dynamic view, which basically tells us how do they communicate, and what is the main object. I cannot call it, basically, before there was this master-slave terminology, but this is totally banned now. So it's basically main server client architecture. So you have to talk, you have to express it in this way, the standard way that is used today. Now, the next phase after you have the architectural design is the detailed design, which is you have to identify what are the classes that you need to use to implement the project. Basically, the main type of objects that are used in the project, designing the models and subsystem models. And we'll go over each one individually. So object class identification is basically identifying the object classes, and this most difficult part of object-oriented design. So you are given a natural language description of the system, and you have to identify what are the relations, if you think about in relational databases concept, that you will develop, what are the possible properties for every relation and types of those properties. And there is no magic formula for object identification. It's basically you obtain it through practice. And you will see that you rely on skill and as you get more experienced programmer and designer, you will basically have higher knowledge of how you break it, identify the main classes and the main objects. And it's an iterative process. So first, in every single development job, you actually identify the schema, then you read again the document, you try to map the verbs to actually relationships in your schema, the nouns to either classes or properties, and then you actually build the entire model or database in this system. And it's unlikely that anyone gets it first time. After 14 years of actual programming large projects, I do an initial draft, then I iterate over it again, incrementally change properties, add properties, delete properties, move them to a different class and so on. And this is what you should do. And it takes sometimes 10 iterations to get it right. There are approaches that help you to identify object classes, use a grammatical approach like the one that I described, that verbs are relationships, nouns are classes or objects. Try to identify part of relationships, that name is a part of a person, same age is a part property of person, and so on. It allows you to base the identification on tangible things in the domain, in the application domain. Use behavioral approach and identify the objects based on what participates in that behavior. Use scenario-based analysis, like identify the objects, the attributes, the methods in each scenario. And that will allow you to actually develop this class diagram. Then the next phase is basically design models, and they show the objects and classes and the relationships between these entities. And there are two kinds of design models: structural models, which are the static structure like class diagrams of the system in terms of objects, inheritance, relationships, and dynamic models, which is the dynamic interaction between these objects. So again, we are using UML sequence diagrams to show how the objects interact with each other, what calls what under what method. And you saw this was done also for integration modeling of a large system, but there they were basically calling a system calls another system, and what is the result return. So this is done at different levels, but in the same way, in the same incremental way. And there are many examples of design models, like subsystem models, where you show the logical grouping of objects into coherent subsystems. Sequence models, where you show the sequence of object iterations, interactions. State machine models, where you show the individual objects' state changes in response to events. And other models like use case models, aggregation models, generalization models, and so on. So all of these actually, they basically correspond to one standard visual way to actually do a design. And the reason for that is that sometimes these need to be presented to customers, and customers do not understand code, but they do understand visual ways or representation of classes, of interaction between objects in sequence diagrams, and so on. So really, there are semester-long classes in a business school where they actually teach UML diagrams, how to develop these kind of designs. Because really what CEOs of startups do, they actually develop requirement analysis documents and design documents. So the subsystem models, they show the design, how the design is organized into related groups of objects, basically the subsystems of the whole overall system. And again, in the UML class, in the UML diagrams, these are shown using packages. What are the various packages in the system? An encapsulating construct, this is logically, it's a logical model. And actual organizations of objects in the system may be different. So in most cases, you would have the classes that are related in the same package, but sometimes there are classes which are related to multiple packages. So you have to choose one place to put them, but they are still related to to the other classes that are identical, okay, are similar. Sequence models are basically related to sequence diagrams. They show how objects interact, interaction takes place. Objects are arranged horizontally across the top. So basically you have the different objects and each of them has a vertical axis. On the vertical axis, you have time. So time is represented vertically. So models are red top to bottom. And interactions are represented by labeled arrows. You will basically see basically arrows that are pointing from one object when a method is called to another object. And there are different styles of arrows that represent different types of interactions. Sometimes you have method calls, sometimes you have polymorphism, in which is basically you have a method call, but for a concrete object, not for the general class of or superclass in that case of that object. Thin rectangles in this object lifetime represent the time that the object is controlling the other object in the system. So basically you would have thin diagrams in each one of these vertical bars where a method is called and what is returned. If this object is still alive, it basically calls other methods in the sequence diagram. And it really shows, in most cases, it shows the lifetime of that object, when it between when it was created and when it was destroyed. We will go more in detail in sequence diagrams later this semester when we define the project for this class. State diagrams. So UML also allows you to define what are the possible states of the system. And it shows how the objects respond to different service requests and what is the state transition triggered by these requests. These state diagrams are useful high-level models of the system or an object's runtime behavior. Usually, they are very useful for games because in a game, you have a system state diagram that tells you in what state of the game you are currently. You are in the settings page or you are in the selection of the properties of the user, like you select the agent, selects a different, let's say, tool. And then there is the game, basically screen and so on. So it's really a state diagram that you can identify at any moment what state you are in or what state is the game. We don't usually need a state diagram for all the objects in the system because many of the objects are relatively simple, but still state models adds detail to the design. Sometimes unnecessary, but in most cases is helpful for the customer. Once we finish the design phase in the waterfall model, we move to coding or the implementation phase. And it really takes place in multiple phases. So sometimes there is a general process of managing, changing the software system called configuration management. The aim of it is to support system integration process for all developers to access the project code, the documents in a controlled way. All developers can find out what changes have been made, and all developers can compile and link components to create the system. So the configuration management is a higher level view of the basically the entire system. Sometimes there are tools like build managers that are basically integrated in this configuration system. If you look at the Linux development, usually you have config, which basically checks what are all of the available subsystems and that you can use, like compilers and other subsystem, other basically parts. And then you configure the system to use those specific compilers. And then you move to the next phase, which is build. And basically make is a build manager that allows you to basically build the overall system out of the components. Is kind of like a script that goes over compiling all of the files in all of the folders, creating the interactions between these, generating the source, the final binaries, and so on. Now, In implementation, you have to follow standard management activities. And one that we will talk about later, but I hope you already have a little bit of experience with, is version management. And there are tools, again, developed for keeping track of different versions of the software component. And nowadays, basically, Git took all over the version management or source code management system. It includes facilities to coordinate development by several programmers, basically all of the diff tools that you can basically see what was developed by other developers and basically merging the two different versions. System integration, and we'll talk more about version management later. I don't have the confidence that all of you are basically experts in Git or other basically version management systems. So we'll actually have a class on version management later this semester. System integration, it helps developers define what version of the component are used to create each version of the system. Descriptions used to build the system automatically by compiling and linking required components. So for large projects developed over several months and years, you have different versions of the libraries that were used. And when you want to generate a version for a specific customer that purchased the system, let's say 2 years ago, you want to give that customer a system that is standard for that system 2 years ago, unless the customer or you are making the current system available. But which usually for this kind of like large systems, the customers are actually quite hard to move to newer versions. They want, if you have security updates, they want to have their system, the original system, secure with original libraries, with original everything. So really in this configuration management system, it has to be robust enough to actually generate binaries that integrate the security updates, but for the different versions of the system that was developed, or the version 2 years ago that the customer, X customer, got used to, and for version Y that is for a different customer, and so on. And overall, there should be a basically bug tracking system that allows the users to report bugs and other problems, and basically for developers to basically track the fix of these bugs. So it started with systems like Bugzilla that are basically standard frameworks to follow up bugs up to completion, how to fix, and Jira and so on. Basically, they are management systems that allow one to track the detection, documentation, implementation, fix of a bug. Now, overall, there are also IDEs. So development platform tools are all the possible tools that allow the developer to integrate a compiler, syntax-directed editing system to allow the code creation, editing, and compilation. And for all of these, there is an overall language debugging system, graphical tools like UML modeling, like Rational from IBM, testing tools like JUnit that allows running of tests of a new version of the program, and project support tools that help organize the code for different development processes, projects. Most important for you is choose a good IDE. So up to now, I assume that you used Eclipse in 1.14, 2.14 maybe. You probably moved on to NetBeans or IntelliJ or even Visual Studio, which we will try to use in this class. And basically, these are all IDEs. They are software development tools that group everything that is needed for the development of a project. It's a set of tools that support editing, debugging, running, justification in some cases of the answers that you get. They are embedded in common frameworks and user interfaces. Most of these are online these days, but not all of them. So For instance, I worked in companies even last summer that the entire development is done online. Facebook has such a system. Basically, it's an ID. Everything is done online. There is no more standalone application that you download to run on your own machine. But that's a company that has probably 100,000 employees at this point. So they have the support to actually develop an IDE for the use of that company only. So IDEs are created to support development in a specific programming language such as Java or C or Python or JavaScript. The language IDE may be developed specifically for that language, may be instantiated from a general purpose IDE, like Eclipse is a general purpose IDE, but you can have Eclipse for C developers or Eclipse for Java developers, or even Eclipse for Java EE developers. So basically a subset of Java developers that use a specific branch of that IDE. After the process of implementation coding is completed, in the waterfall model comes validation, which is really everything about testing. Testing, unit testing, system testing, integration testing, regression testing. So program testing is intended to show if a program does what is intended to do and if the program has defects before it's put to use. So these are validation tests done by programmers, testers in specifically. So software testing is that a program is now executed with artificial data. Results of the tests are run to check for errors, abnormalities, information about the program's non-functional attributes, like what memory was used, like profiling, what time took for every algorithm, and can reveal the presence of errors, not their absence. So basically, you cannot declare that an error is not there just because you don't find it. If you find it, then you have the error, but you cannot completely test the system to say that the error is not there. So testing is part of a more general verification and validation process, which also includes static validation techniques. So basically, there are multiple processes that are used in software engineering for testing. And actually, testing is done from the design phase. If you look at over Somerville's textbook, which I only want to summarize in these 40, 50 slides that I will go over today, is basically a very long process that describes testing of systems. Now, verification is different than validation. One is a formal process and the other one is actually practical process for the actual program. So verification is the formal process. The question there that we are trying to answer to is, are we building the right product and the product right? And really the goal there is that, is the software conform to the specification? And validation is, the question, are we building the product right, but are we building the right product, which is really that the software should do what the user really requires, not what is written in the requirements, the specification document. So there are this nuance between verification and validation. We are doing verification in the software coding phase, the implementation phase. And even in that phase, we are doing multiple stages of testing. There is development testing, where the system is tested during development to discover bugs, logical errors, and defects, which is done through unit testing. Every method is tested individually. Every package is tested individually. And then integration testing, where you actually test a workflow that basically this integration of multiple packages is done correctly. And then there is release testing. So there was the development testing, which is done during development, and then the release testing, where a separate testing team tests a complete version of the system before it's released to the user. And this is called full qual testing in many cases is basically full qualification testing. It validates each requirement out of thousands of requirements and is done, as I said, in a mode called black box testing. Like, this separate team of testers do not know and they do not care how the system is implemented. They test the requirements individually, developed out of, all these tests are developed out of the requirements directly. They have no way to view how the system is internally implemented. And this is called black box testing. If you know what the system actually does internally, like you know the steps of an algorithm in a method, and you want to test every single possible execution path to that method, that is called a white glass box testing. Basically, you know exactly what are, there are three different ways to run this method. I will make a test for every single of the three ways to make sure that I get in every possible execution workflow the correct result. But the release testing is done in a black box manner. Development testing. So each one of these, we take it separately. So development testing includes all testing activities that are carried out by the development team of the system. And it has multiple levels. So the first level is unit testing. Each individual unit could be a program, could be an object, are tested individually. And they focus on the functionality of methods, of objects. Basically, every object has to have the behavior that is specified. Every method has the behavior that is specified. Once we are done testing individually the methods, we go to component testing, where several individual units are integrated to create a composite component, a kind of integration testing, where you basically have, oh, in order to execute, let's say, a login, I have to send message or username and password to an encryption service, then I have a decryption service, I have to send it now to a database and so on. So you test multiple, it's like a method that calls multiple subroutines, and you are testing this workflow. So component testing should focus on testing component interfaces. It sends input to the component and sees what it comes out. And it checks the correctness for that. And it's not for a single method, it's for basically a component, a larger method, which may actually is only used for testing. May actually not implement any part that is used for delivering functionality. And finally, there is the overall system testing, where all the components of the system are integrated and one or multiple tests are run through the entire system as a whole. So many years ago, I worked in the IBM Watson team that developed the project that played the Jeopardy game with human champions. And we had all of these tests. Every method that we would develop, we would have a unit test. At the end of every package development, we would have a component testing. And every night, we would have regression testing running over the entire system. So we would see that changes that we made in a certain component didn't break other tests that, like, for instance, we were counting how many questions and what questions we get right and in Jeopardy. And of course, if we made a test and that solves maybe one question, but it breaks 10 more, then we would want to detect it as fast as possible. So we were running every night the system over 100,000 Jeopardy clues, and we knew it was basically all previous Jeopardy clues. We would know what would be the answer that was the correct answer, the expected answer. So unit testing is the process of testing every individual component in isolation. Isolation is the important word here. Units may be individual functions or methods within an object, and object classes with several attributes and methods can also be tested using unit testing. And basically the best example for this is JUnit for Java. Release testing is the process of testing a release of a system intended for outside use, outside the development team. And the primary goal is to convince the supplier of the system that is good to use, is it good enough to use. In the end, release testing has to show that the system delivers functionality, performance, and dependability, and the system doesn't fail during normal use. So it basically, even if in many cases it has artificial data, it shows that overall the system works properly. And again, it's done in a black box testing process where tests are derived only from the system specification, the requirements-based testing. Release testing and system testing are related. It's basically a release testing is a form of system testing. There are important differences. A separate team not involved with the system development is responsible for the release testing, as I said earlier. System testing is developed, it's done by development team, and it should focus on discovering bugs in the system, defect testing. And objects of release testing is, the object of release testing is to test that the system meets the requirements and is good enough for external use, is validation testing. So release testing is done by testers, and system testing can be done by the team that developed the system. Now, once we finish testing, we go to deployment. So this stage is actually quite large. If you look at Somerville, it covers one chapter on all the deployment tools and basically choosing the right system and choosing the right build manager and so on. But this stage usually involves... Okay, it looks like I don't know how to spell involves, so I will just spell it afterwards. Involves a dry run of with a reduced system but real user data. You give real user data and check if the system works fine. And finally, it's basically a full deployment on the cloud or on the client's actual system. Now, there is a saying that it takes 10% of the time to develop a project and 90% of the time to actually maintain it and keep it alive, which is totally correct. Basically, I haven't seen a single system that you develop it and you deliver it and you never have to touch it again, ever. In 14 years of development, I haven't seen such a case. Changes are required by the user after deployment, new requirements, modified requirements, sometimes bug fixes, deficiencies that were not caught in testing. This process should be organized such that changes can be traced. Generally, design processes assure that there are links between requirements, architecture design, and test cases and procedures. And documentation must be maintained during evolution. So this is actually the most important phase in any development. It's relatively easy to develop a project if you don't have to do maintenance afterwards. Basically, you develop a project and you deliver it to the customer and then you never have to touch it again. As I said, is 10% of what usually in real world happens. Because sometimes, as I said, there are bugs, sometimes technologies changes, sometimes new requirements, either functional requirements or even constraint requirements, then now the system has to evolve from 100,000 users to 100 million users because of a pandemic. So typical processes adopted in maintenance and evolution is that the change update proposed by the user may include, should include specific dependency or information on the new requirement, a deficiency and information on the new requirement, rationale for it, other info. A change control board reviews these requests and responds, accepts, assigns personal persons responsible for the change. In some cases, actually determines the cost for that change. It can reject the change. Maybe it's a feature that is not covered by the maintenance contract, or it can request for additional info, like specific additional data for clarification of the change on the change. Once approved, now it has to go through all the phases that we saw in any project development. Requirements have to be updated and reviewed. Design have to be modified and reviewed, again with state diagrams, class diagrams, and sequence diagrams. Implementation code has to be written and modified, and new code has to be tested, possible regression testing done, and finally the changes have to be accepted by the customer. And all of this has to be updated in the source code and documentation versioning. And that's kind of a crash course on software engineering. So really, you should know the main keywords of software engineering and software development lifecycle, because we will apply them in real projects later this semester. And I finished quite on time. It's 5:55 or 6 p.m. Let's see. I assume that there are some questions in the chat. If anyone has a question that you want me to respond to and was not responded yet, please just say it, because there are many, many sentences in the chat. So before I stop recording, anyone has a specific question that they asked, you can unmute yourself and ask it, and we'll go over it. Yes, so one question that I see is, are the slides available? Yes, on the course website. And they are always posted before the class. I try to do that. I actually posted this last night. But you have to understand that this is the first time that I'm teaching this class. So really, it's an incremental development process. You can call it agile, that I'm developing the lecture notes before every class. And I have it very fresh in my mind, because I just finished these slides a day ago. Okay, so understand that this is a new class, and also this schedule is tentative, and we really try to do our best to teach a class on software fundamentals, development fundamentals. And all slides will be available before the class as much as possible. I will always try to do this. I always did this in 9 years of teaching. This is my 10th year. And it will be available on the course website, which is linked both from the course website and from Piazza. Here is the course website on Piazza. Okay, let's see if there are any other questions. I don't remember what slide that was on and what is the correct question. So I will basically, I will try to go over these questions and respond them on Piazza. That's the easiest way if I don't really understand at this point what is the question about. I do not know if I will use Bitbucket or GitHub. There is also GitHub Classroom, which allows me to actually create a GitHub for every student in the class and give you basically a start code that you can contribute to. So it's still to be decided if we are going to use GitHub, GitHub Classroom, or Bitbucket. Okay, so it soon seems that everybody says bye. So and there are no quizzes today. So that's all. I will stop the recording. Yes, you will be tested on what this lecture is about, is standard software engineering. Only what is in the lecture, nothing outside, because I try to summarize everything that is done in a standard software engineering course. So only what is in the lecture, it's possible to be tested. I see. So in that slide on writing good requirements, there was that requirements must be individually defined one at a time with no if statements. Basically, the given the current state, what is the effect of a certain event? So that's where I was saying that there shouldn't be any if statements. You shouldn't have cases that now in this event, I will check if some state of the database is X and something else is Y. So that's why there are so many different requirements, because each requirement has to be individual for given these inputs and this state of the database, what is the output? Quizzes, okay, so let's return back to the quizzes. So quizzes will be posted before the class, and they will only be due at the end of next day. So really, you will have time to actually review the lecture after I post it, which I do immediately after the class, and then basically respond to the quiz to the best of your ability. Usually, quizzes is just an active way to basically learn the material that is taught in class. Yes, of course, it's open notes. You have quizzes. Exams are logged on browser. Quizzes are just Google everything that you want. It will help you actually read more and find more information on that topic. Okay, thank you very much. We finished just on time, 6:05. So I will stop the recording and post it on the course website. Have a good day.